I'm Molly, I'm a Data and Analytics Director here at Jellyfish, although I'm actually based up north in our Manchester office. But I'm going to talk to you in a little bit more depth about the first of those three pillars that's just been introduced. So we're going to talk about kind of foundations of technology. I'm going to start with a bit of a favourite topic for me. We're going to talk about Google Analytics 4. And I know that for those of you in the room who are Jellyfish clients, you'll already be really familiar with GA4. I think we're probably already working with most of you on kind of your adoption plans and this idea of kind of migrating over to using GA4 as kind of that primary source of truth. But so maybe let's just sort of step back a second and actually think a little bit more about like the context and the journey that we've been to get us to this point. You know, Universal Analytics has been the platform that a lot of us have been familiar with and been using for quite a number of years now. But ultimately, you know, it's kind of very much rooted in a landscape that no longer really exists. And actually, when we're thinking about Google Analytics 4, this is a platform that has been completely rebuilt from the ground up with these privacy concerns kind of at the core of that design. So, you know, a lot of us are having these conversations at the moment, working towards thinking about the migration. You know, we've got the sunset date for next year. Actually, next year might seem a long way away, but when we start to think about wanting to have like a full year of data for those kind of year-on-year comparisons, that deadline comes a lot closer. So we're really talking about prioritizing what are those like key pieces of information that we need to have in to be able to do that year-on-year look back. One of the big conversations that I'm having with a lot of my clients at the moment is actually from a people point of view and starting to think about what are sort of the kind of the skills and the training that we need to bed into the teams now to make sure that we've got the skills and that we're prepared for this transition. So I suppose like the good news for all of those analytics teams who've like built out that really strong technical skill within Universal Analytics is that those skills absolutely are transferable. There's going to be so much here that feels familiar and concepts that you're already used to working with. But now is a really good time to start thinking about what are almost the key differentiators that make GA4 different and what do we need to sort of get our heads around to make sure that we're prepared to make use of it in the best way. So when you're thinking about kind of training needs for your teams at the moment, in particular, I think if you're the team who are responsible for perhaps the implementation, the configuration side of things, you're going to want to start thinking about these key differentiators. Perhaps you're thinking about the fact that, you know, we're moving beyond the kind of like this kind of fragmented platform view, and we're moving around, you know, not just bringing in the best of analytics for web, but actually starting to think about app and about Firebase and expanding our knowledge into this like proper cross-platform skill set. I think another thing as well for us to start to think about is that actually the data model in GA4 is quite different to what you'll be used to in Universal. So making sure that your teams are kind of starting to think in that way and how we can make the best use of that new data structure and how we're going to map that out against our business needs. So this is the kind of planning conversations that we're having at the moment. But in terms of the time that we have together today, what I really wanted to do was almost to just pick out for you which almost are like the key themes that jump out for me within Google Analytics 4. What are these key themes that we want to be able to think about in terms of how we make the most of the platform? Yes, we will talk about data collection, okay? I know everyone's super keen to talk about data collection. Like, we're here talking today a lot about privacy, and data collection is one of the areas that has been most significantly impacted by the privacy changes, so we will definitely talk about that. But I also just wanted to take this step back and make sure that we also look at the full life cycle of our data flowing right through, not just about the data that we collect, but also like how are we using that data? How is it feeding into our report, our analysis, the insights that we're doing? And actually, you know, I know for a lot of the analytics teams in the room, but actually those of you who are here maybe from the marketing team, from the product team, you're going to be wanting to ask this question of actually, how do I use the data? What is this end goal of how we kind of drive towards like activation, optimization of the data? So, you know, I think we've moved beyond that kind of phase where we're just like collecting all the data for the sake of collecting it. And we're being a lot more mindful now about wanting to think, well, actually, you know, what is the end goal that we're trying to achieve? What is it that we need to be able to do? And we're going to work back from there and define your measurement strategy to be based around your business needs, you know, rather than the other way around. So these are kind of the key themes that I want to use our time together today to chat through. Let's get into the data collection, because I know this is like a fun, meaty topic that everyone's going to be really keen to talk about, so we can go into this in a bit more detail. Some of the key things I maybe want to call out here, I suppose we've talked a lot about privacy, and there are some really exciting changes, fundamental differences when we think about the way that GA4 has been built. And it's already been mentioned quite a lot in the previous sessions that, you know, we're seeing less and less observable cookie data, and we want to move away from our reliance on kind of cookie-based identifiers for our device space. So actually with Google Analytics 4, we're moving much more into using various like logged in signals to build up that connectivity. So whether it's to do with like your own like customer identifiers, whether that's to do with Google's logged in data, or kind of the hierarchy of how we use those different logged in identifiers to build up much more of a kind of user-centric kind of cross-platform view. So already you can see that just at the core, at its fundamentals, Google Analytics 4 is a lot more kind of robust and reliable in terms of like the foundation that it's been built on. Another piece that I think is really worth us talking about here as well is like around the data structure in particular. And we talked briefly already about this event-based data model. We're saying goodbye ultimately to this kind of old event category action label. Like we're leaving those things behind. And I suppose one piece of advice that I'd want to give and what I'd want to urge you all to think about is to resist the temptation to almost like migrate over your legacy taxonomy and just to bring that over because that's the way that you've always done it. Like, you know, that might be easier now in the short term because those are the values that you already have in your data layer or that's the way that it's been built. But I think I would really say like GA4 is your blank slate. Like this is your chance. And actually the new data model is like arguably a lot better. You've got a lot more flexibility. So this is your chance for the kind of blank slate to design what that taxonomy needs to look like, what that structure needs to look like, and design that around the needs of your business. So I think this is probably a really, really crucial point for us to call out. Okay, so you've collected a load of data, all those streams are set up, it's all coming in, you're feeling good. What is the first thing that you're going to want to do? I know you're going to want to roll your sleeves up, you're going to want to get your hands on some of this data. I think the first place that you're going to go is going to be directly into the interface. And a lot of what you'll find there will be really familiar. So in terms of like the standard reports, the look and feel of the interface, there's going to be a lot there that you're recognizing from Universal Analytics. But actually, as you start to get into that data, as you start to explore that, you're going to find that actually GA4 is a lot more flexible, it's a lot more agile in terms of the way that you can adapt and use those reports. So you can kind of almost follow your own lines of inquiry and like follow the thought that you have to explore that data directly within the interface. I think this is going to have a really significant impact on just the way that you find those small day-to-day little pieces of insight. I know you're going to want to go beyond that though. So for most of you, there's going to be like more that you're going to want to do on top of that. And this is where we then start to talk about integrations. So it's going to depend on your use case and the kind of thing that you want to do. But you know, say for example, you're talking about like dashboarding, wanting to build these kind of visual data sharing tools and have a way to design visual information that's relevant to your different stakeholder groups and kind of almost just control who has access to what based on what they need. Thinking about an integration at that point with Data Studio directly with GA4, that's going to be a really, really powerful tool in that scenario. Equally, if your ambition is around like kind of wanting to get all your data in one place and be able to play around with it a lot more and explore it for that deeper analysis, that's the kind of scenario where you're going to be thinking about BigQuery. So you can start to build up this picture now of the different options you have based on the different type of exploration that you want to do. Kind of, you know, whether it's directly within the interface or whether you're making use of these integrations, you've got a lot of different options for exploring and reporting within your data. I'm going to move on for a second and talk a little bit about some of the kind of advanced sort of analysis and insight capabilities that are present in GA4 and quite new for GA4. I suppose one thing for us to actually think about, which is going to feed right back into our data collection, into our measurement strategy, is actually to be aware of some of the machine learning kind of predictive insight capabilities that GA4 has now. Because this is going to inform how you design that measurement collection strategy in the first place. Because if you think about, for example, something just like your property structure, like what you're going to define as your property structure and then how you're going to make use of maybe like the, you know, sub-properties and roll-ups, you want to be, you know, with that, always keeping in mind, well, GA4 would see a property as a user base. That's defined as a user base. We want them to be a group of people that it makes sense for us to learn from their behavior as a group, right? So that might be, you know, you're going to say that these are all users of a certain brand, you know, one brand, but across platforms, so app and web for a single brand. That makes logical sense for them to be considered as a user base. And then all of the benefits of GA4 from like a machine learning predictive insight perspective apply logically to that group. So being aware of these kinds of capabilities at the point that you're designing your measurement strategy is going to make sure that you get the most out of the platform further down the line. When we're talking about the point of kind of modeling to offset data loss, I know it's been mentioned a little bit already, and I'm going to talk more about that when we come to consent mode, so I'll park that one for a second. But I would just like to mention to you about data-driven attribution, because I think this is a concept that's probably familiar. You've probably used data-driven attribution perhaps in some of your reports within Universal Analytics, maybe within your ad tech. But actually, the version of data-driven attribution that we have as standard within GA4, it's new, it's improved, it's a different beast, you know? And actually, we're talking here about being able to make use, again, of using that much more, the kind of the stronger signals from using that logged-in device space, the greater volume of touch points that are feeding into this model that make it a lot more powerful. And this is going to become really, really relevant in a second when we start to then talk about activation. So we've come to this now, the big hurrah. What are we going to actually do with this data? We've collected all this stuff, we've had a play with it, we've put it in some dashboards. What are we going to be able to actually do with this information? How are we going to use this information to basically be better at our jobs every day? How is this data going to help me be a better marketer, right? There are a few things we can think about, and I would definitely start by talking about integration. So we've already just talked about, you know, this logged-in device space, data-driven attribution. Now think you can integrate GA4 directly with your ad tech. So previously, we've always had this reliance on the observable cookie data when we're thinking about things like bid optimization. If you start to imagine GA4 as almost being this kind of central foundation of your measurement, and you're going to be bringing all your ad tech and linking into that one place, you can bid directly to conversions within GA4. So you can start to think that the power that that's going to have of leveraging all the benefits that we've been talking about, everything we've just built and layered up, you're now going to be able to leverage all of that integrated directly into your ad tech. One final thing that I would like to talk about when we're talking about kind of activation of GA4 data is also this idea of controlling what we can control. And one aspect of that, I think, has to be around optimization of our own assets. So we're talking about, you know, potentially about your website journeys, your experience, your own assets. And you know, if you think actually about integrating with a tool like Google Optimize, being able to directly integrate that with GA4, being able to then run experiments, personalization on your own journeys and experiences on your website, right? Ultimately, what you're doing there is ensuring that for every user who lands on your site, you're giving them the best possible chance of having some sort of valuable outcome for your business. And ultimately, of course, any improvements that you're making to conversion rate and optimizing that within your experiences, that's going to have a knock-on impact to all of your media across the board as well. So it kind of it all echoes out. So you can start to see how these things will just all fit together and the kind of compound impact of making use of these different little bits of tools. I'm going to just talk to you a little bit now about consent mode. It was mentioned earlier. And so okay, we've talked about GA4, where, you know, we have the idea of these themes of our data collection and then ultimately what we do with our data. Consent mode then is ultimately about kind of adding on, layering extra tools that are going to fit together in this ecosystem. What else are we plugging in and how does this kind of supercharge what we're doing? When we talk about privacy, obviously, we're saying it's really important for us to be respecting users' privacy choices. And we always need to be thinking about leaning into that and not trying to kind of push against it or hack around it. We want to be respecting those choices. And for me, this is where consent mode is like a really powerful bit of kit that you're going to want to plug into the rest of what you've built. Ultimately, if you think about, you know, if you've been having conversations in your organization, or maybe it's happening now, about making changes to the mechanism by which users give consent, so whether you're like changing your CMP, making changes to the interactions within your cookie banner. And ultimately, what we see with clients is at the point at which that change is made, we start to see a real decline in opt-in rate from users at that point. Obviously, then we have less and less observable data, fewer observed conversions. And this means that we've got less correctly attributed conversion data to feed into our downstream systems. So it's making an impact on the performance of all of our activity beyond that. With consent mode, what you can essentially do is that you're able to monitor the state of that user opt-in. And essentially, consent mode, I'll oversimplify here, but consent mode essentially kind of tells your Google tags to change their behavior depending what we can see about the consent status. How that's going to like translate for you within your reports is that where a user is opted in, great, you can see the conversion, you can track that conversion in your report as an observed conversion as usual. But where we've not got consent, we're essentially making use of anonymized pings to be able to kind of model and color in that missing piece and fill in the gap so that you can kind of approximate the behavior that you would have seen had we been able to track it. There are kind of two different outcomes with consent mode. So I've spoken a lot here about being able to model missing conversion data, but we do have clients who are also involved in a beta with Google at the moment to be using essentially the same methodology, but looking at kind of more behavioral and interaction data. So you can start to see how this is going to have a massive benefit to kind of color in some of those gaps for you. I'll touch really briefly now on one more topic. I feel like I could talk to you about these things all day. We don't have all day. So do come and have a chat to me. I'll be around in the bar later, me or any of the other jellies. It'd be really good to chat to you in some of these topics. But the final thing I just want to mention to you is around the idea of server-side tracking. And this is going to be a conversation that we're having so much more over the next sort of weeks and months. But ultimately, with server-side tracking, we've got what's going to become kind of really foundational kind of cornerstone of the future of our measurement. It's much more resilient, you have much more control, and actually we can start to get excited about the opportunities that this gives us as well, not just for like preserving what we've had in the past, but also how does this help us like drive forward and what innovation can we build with the idea of this new technology? Because in a way, we've been hindered in the past by only being able to share what we were comfortable to pass into the data layer. But if you can imagine with server-side tracking, all of a sudden you've got this ability to maybe send something like profit margin through. Imagine being able to push that then into your downstream systems and how you could use that to optimize your activity. There's suddenly it's opening up of a lot more possibility. So in the time that we've got, this is what we've been able to cover, and I wish I could stay and chat to you a bit more, but I'm hoping that this has given you a good introduction. You can start to see how these things fit together, and you can make choices about what's relevant for you, what you want to, you know, pull together from the best of GA4, bringing in consent mode, server to server, and you can start to build up that kind of strong foundation of measurement that's going to enable you to go and do all of the fun stuff that you'll be spoken to about the break after the break. But kind of on this note, I'd really like to hand you over to Salman, who's a colleague from Meta, and he's going to talk to you a little bit more about some of their stuff.
My name is Salman, and I'm a marketing science partner here at Meta. I'm here to take you through on all things on Convergence API. You might be wondering, that is me, in case you're wondering. That's my pre-pandemic look. This is my pandemic look. It's all gone that way. So yes, the ads ecosystem is changing, and you know, it's giving more power to the people, to the consumers on all things about how the data is controlled, or like more control to on their data, how it's stored, how it's collected, how it's used, how it's how it's shared. But at the same time, we do think that privacy and personalization can coexist. We can see that that personalization and privacy is top of mind for consumers, and we do believe that both can coexist, making sure that we have a data-driven marketing solution that adheres to consumers' privacy decisions. So you might be wondering, what is Convergence API? It's actually good to summarize the enabled capabilities that we've had with the Pixel as well as with Convergence API from a tracking perspective, and more for a reporting as well as a measurement perspective too. So let's take a step back. Let's say, ignoring Pixel as well as Convergence API, let's now go back to, say, no tracking. What could you do without tracking? Right now, you could have had tracked on on-site metrics for media buying performance, of understanding how many impressions were served. But at the same time, you could also use, say, Brad and Lift, which is an incrementality-based solution by Meta, measuring the incremental impact on brand outcomes. But then you may have such business questions like, how many incremental conversions am I getting through Meta's advertising, or how many leads am I getting, and what is the effectiveness of Meta's advertising? This is where this is where the Pixel came into place, so that you're able to track off-site conversions outside of Meta onto your website, and tying that information back to Meta to measure their incremental impact, as well as being able to measure conversions on that front there. And this also leads to conversion lift, being able to measure the incremental impact of your ads by measuring the incremental conversions between exposed and non-exposed groups. But with data privacy becoming more at the core, and browser policy changes at the core as well, the Convergence API will be the next phase when it comes to conversion tracking. And so we do believe that it provides data enhancement or data enrichment, where there would be conversions that would have been lost due to browser changes. This is where the Conversions API comes into play. And also, our measurement solutions will also be evolving on that front there, which I'll discuss a little bit more in regards to conversion lift later today. So many advertisers would be relying on the browser pixel today. So if you're running a performance activity which utilizes Meta's advertising solutions to your website, tracking things like page views or add to cart, etc., you pretty much are using the pixel. And this is really important with regards to ad for like targeting, as well as for optimizing your campaigns and being able to measure the impact of your ads. But this is dependent on browser policy changes, which takes us through to server-side tracking, as well as what we also call it Conversions API. So instead of having data being processed on the browser, it is being processed on a server. So this could be your client server, or it could be a cloud server such as AWS or Google Cloud Platform, and having that direct connection between that server with the marketing platform such as Meta. And here, the main difference that we're seeing here is that the data processing would actually would be moving away from the website, or a website browser, should we say, onto a server on this one here. So that summarizes what Conversions API is about. So what do you unlock with Conversions API, you might be wondering. So adopting Conversions API is the route to having a successful data-driven marketing strategy on this one here, which unlocks on more reliable data, as well as sophisticated data, as well as improved measurement capabilities. And this helps to adopt towards a changing ads ecosystem, and hopefully en route to a more privacy-enhancing tech as well later on. So this helps with the reliable data point here with regards to improved targeting as well as custom audiences, as it helps to be able to retarget onto those customers who you care about most, with the use of cross-channel custom audiences, as well as improved identity matching as well. As with improved identity matching, with better match rates, be able to retarget better, and this helps with optimization on this one here. This also includes on a more sophisticated data. Now, if we take a step back and talk a little bit about Meta's ad delivery system, which relies on machine learning, we usually informally say what you pay for is what you get. So if you want to optimize for reach, you will get reach. If you optimize for add to cart, you'll get add to cart. And so we want to maximize the number of results per budget spend on that front there. So what's actually really interesting with Conversions API is that you'd be able to go further down the funnel. And businesses would actually like to optimize towards closer to where profits are being made. In this front here, you'll be able to go further than the purchase. With Conversions API, you'd probably be able to optimize towards subscriptions. So rather than just on a 7-day trial, you could actually optimize towards a subscription completed after that seven-day trial. Lead quality, so you'll be able to optimize towards those who are more likely to convert after a lead rather than just on pure volume. Custom web events, so website activity that you deem fit to optimize towards, that could also be possible. And non-web events, which is actually quite useful for those for clients with a sophisticated CRM system as well, where you'll be able to pass that back in with the Conversions API. And also on measurement. So I did highlight earlier on that some of our measurement solutions are evolving as well. And Conversion Lift is one of those. And Conversion Lift, like a quick summary, is an incrementality-based solution by Meta, measuring the incremental conversions between those who were exposed to advertising and those who weren't. And with that front here, we are also evolving. It's also going through its evolution as well, which also happened since October, where it's enabled by Conversions API, and it's now a requirement. But here, we're true to measuring the true business impact of conversions, of advertising through conversions, but minimizing the amount of data that is processed at the individual level, should I say. And so so we are using more data that's de-identified and the data is aggregated as well for those who have opted out, such as of iOS 14.5. But before I go on a bit more on implementing a convergence API, it's actually really important to highlight on one other thing, and that's EMQ scores. So you might be wondering, what is EMQ on this one here? So this is about how you indicate how effective customer information may be at matching your event to a meta account. And this is actually very useful, or should I say important, for targeting as well as for optimization. And this is based on the parameters that you pass back, so things like email or phone or user agent, etc. It is a score out of 10, but we in Meta, we do recommend a score of 6 and above, and this is so that we have a good enough read on conversions that are being passed back. And this is also a requirement from using Conversion Lift as well that we would recommend to clients and agencies on this one. Now we talked about what you can unlock with Conversions API, it would be quite interesting to talk about what are the implementation routes as well with Conversions API. So there are three main buckets if we were to highlight it here. So one is with the Conversions API gateway. So this is where Meta has developed a solution for all in regards to implementing a server-to-server integration with the use of AWS. It is meant to like replicate the Facebook pixel or the Meta pixel on that front there. Direct integration, you can customize your Conversions API server-to-server integration, and you can also customize it towards your business needs. So there's a lot of customization and tailoring to what you'd like as well. And finally, with the partner solution, you can get support from over 50 Meta business partners, such as WooCommerce, Shopify, Google Tag Manager, and so there's a plethora of solutions out there as well. There's also a highlight around the advantages as well as the considerations. Because whilst the Conversions API is important, it's also really important to know what offerings are available on this one here. So if we were to start from the left to right, with Conversions API Gateway is there to replicate the pixel as well as leveraging the pixel as well. It doesn't require much development as well. However, do bear in mind that it does require an AWS account. However, there is a beta opportunity around expanding the cloud on this front here, where Google Cloud Platform as well as Azure is also open as well. So if this is of interest, do get in contact with Meta on this front here. With direct integration, as I said, full control and customization, do bear in mind that it does require an in-house developer team, and it may take a longer time on that setup as well. And finally, on the partner solution, it's more of a turnkey solution, more of a turnkey setup where you're able to outsource your Conversions API implementation to the partner. But also do bear in mind that there may be less customization. However, I would also say that because different partners have different offerings, it's always good to ask what type of offering do they have, because some may be able to provide like deeper funnel optimization, some may require more coding. These would be really important to iron out on. I'll finalize on this slide here. Obviously, this is like the product support or like some of the measurement that is enabled with Conversions API. It is subject to change. Well, one thing's for sure, though, is that with conversion lift or lift measurement in general would be enabled through any form of Conversions API implementation. Although we would say that some of the requirements should be in place, such as following brilliant basics for sure, as well as having an EMQ score of at least 6 and above. Lead quality optimization, this would probably be more useful from a direct integration implementation, and it could also be available via some partners as well. And finally, with a private lift measurement beta, it's currently with the Conversions API gateway, if that's of interest, but this is subject to change. It might open up to other Conversions API implementation, but if so, then do get in contact. We'd definitely like to discuss more on that front there. I think that's pretty much it from my end, and I think the next thing we've got is a coffee break. So if you've got more questions, I'd love to have it over coffee or double espresso. That's usually my way. Thank you.